Let me start by quoting a very wise man. I love the Eagles too. It's important to get off to a good start on this. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce to you our next honorary degree recipient, Pamela Randy Waller. I should start by saying that I had the privilege of meeting Ms. Waller a few months ago over a dinner downtown. Like any good development professional, that's what I do for a whole time, I'm doing development work. I did my research on Tam. I wanted to be sure that I had done my due diligence prior to our dinner and that I knew all about her. But, and this is much to my surprise, every time I wanted to say something about her, something about her history, some little factoid, she would blurt out something about me instead. She had actually done her homework and her due diligence. So for those of you, there probably aren't many, that remember the old Mad magazine, this was a classic spy versus spy scenario. So I guess I should have been surprised that this talent was part of her impressive skill set. What should be obvious to all of us is that Pamela Randy Waller is a force to be reckoned with. Now, Pam is best known as the founder of Phil Buckets, an organization that started in 1984 from her home in Roxborough, same place that I grew up. An organization that is dedicated to eliminating hunger and improving food access for families. Phil Abundance, under her guidance, quickly became a model for other cities as a way to use an untapped source of emergency food, surplus food. You see, Pam saw the missing link. People were willing to donate the food that families, especially children, desperately needed, but there was no system in place to collect and distribute the food. That's where Phil Abundance came in. And the simple idea of getting surplus food to where it was needed quickly started. More than three decades later, Phil Abundance is the largest hunger relief agency in the region, distributing 25 million pounds of food each year. 25 million pounds of food to soup kitchens, food pantries, shelters, and after-school programs, providing nutritious food to more than 90,000 people per week. Now, Phil Abundance also distributes to the region's most vulnerable, including seniors and children. It also operates the Phil Abundance Community Kitchen, a culinary arts training and job placement program for low-income adults. They also offer counseling services where Holy Family students often intern. Their Fair and Square grocery store opened in 2013 to serve residents in Chester, a former food desert. It is the first nonprofit grocery store of its kind that is serving its community with low prices and healthy food options. But there's more. Pam knows that the fight is not over. She now serves on the Phil Abundance Board, guiding the organization through key developmental stages, like the purchase of their first warehouse in South Philadelphia. She also serves on the Fair and Square Board and the Board of Generosity Community Alliance and the Mural Arts Program Advisory Council. Pam also mentors and advises others on strategies for developing and sustaining social impact ventures, as well as surviving various organization transitions and life cycle challenges. Some of Philadelphia's most innovative social impact organizations are now benefiting from her extraordinary expertise. Pam currently serves as a senior fellow at the Fellows Institute of Government at the University of Pennsylvania, where she is a guest lecturer. She provides career advice to Fellows students, develops student internship opportunities, and writes for the Fellows Recap blog. By the way, she also ran for mayor against Ed Red Bell in 1991. And although Ed did win that election, word on the street is he was very, very afraid of Pam. Now, it should be apparent to all that Pam's personal mission and dedication in life, and in all that she has accomplished professionally, aligns so closely to the mission of this university, her unwavering commitment to family, to learning, and to service, makes her the most deserving recipient of the Doctor of Humane Letters at Holy Family University.
Pamela Randy Waller, would you please come to the center of the stage? I am pleased to accept the candidate, Pamela Randy Waller, the degree of to all the honors, rights, and privileges pertaining to this degree. Sister Maureen, Dr. Garvey, faculty, administration, trustees, parents, family, and especially the graduates of the class of 2018, I am so honored to be here this morning, and thank you for welcoming me into the Holy Family family. I, like you, was educated in an environment where faith and service and the principles of truth and justice were the very air that we breathed. It is the foundation. You will find that it is the most important foundation of your life. And the ground in which you have been spending is fertile ground, and so much will come from that. You're so lucky to have been immersed in this environment where you're experiencing the richness, and you have experienced the richness and the intellectual and spiritual rigor that is the Holy Family education. As I look back on my life, I realize that the Catholic education that I had and the values-based, the virtues-based educational model that ran through my entire educational career really made me the person that I am and guided me throughout my life. It's interesting. There's a lot to talk about, and there are a lot of things that I can talk to you about this morning. But one of the things that is interesting, whenever someone meets me and discovers that they founded Philabundance, they usually ask two questions. What in the world inspired you to do that, and did you ever think that it would become as large as it is? The answer to the first question is pretty straightforward. In 1984, I was working as a writer and editor for corporations and consulting firms, raising a family, renovating a house, living the hectic life of the proverbial two-career couple, and was becoming much more aware of the problem of hunger in the city. The famine in Ethiopia was raging at that time, but I was also reading a book called Starving in the Shadow of Plenty, which opened my eyes to the problem of domestic hunger, which really showed the faces of hunger, what was happening behind the public policies and what was behind the numbers, the data. I find two words that are some of my favorite, and I find that they're important in life: convergence and alignment. What was converging at that time? The political landscape was changing significantly. The gains of the Great Society were being lost by the 80s. Cuts in social services and social programs were really throwing new generations of individuals around the country into poverty. When I was learning about this disparity and finding it difficult to accept, I wondered about. I was spending a lot of time in restaurants and at catered events and doing a lot of cooking myself. And the idea that there were people in my community who didn't have the food that they needed on a daily basis was really very hard to take, really. But I wondered what was. I thought that something must be. Someone must be addressing the problem, and what I wanted to find out whether that was actually the case. I found in talking to people in the food industry and also in the social service industry, what I learned is that food was available and donors wanted to, they had heard about the growing problem of hunger here in the city, and they wanted to donate food, and certainly the agencies could use it. But what was missing was the middleman, and that's really how Philabundance was born. It was a stretch in a way. It's funny, we can talk about ideas, and ideas are powerful, and I am a believer in the power of ideas and one person to make a difference and to be the catalyst in moving that idea forward. After taking a hiatus from my corporate job and developing the transportation system, the logistical system, and the organization structure to support it, I really thought that I would be, and really what I wanted to do was prove that perishable foods could be moved safely and efficiently. It's hard to believe now, but more than 30 years ago, people didn't think you could move food, perishable foods, safely. But the logistics system that I developed was really one of taking it directly from a food donor and to the agency closest that could use it. So it was a very quick turnaround time. I really thought that I was going to just start it, prove that it could be done, prove the naysayers wrong, and that I would spin it off and move on, because it wasn't my line of work. And what I found is that every project, there is the person who is the point person, the entrepreneurial leader who is going to take it, who's going to continue to test it and refine the idea and really make sure that the vision turns into reality. So after realizing that after 2 years it was not something that could be spun off, I really was committed to moving this forward. And as I said, it was a different idea. There are two stories that come to mind from the earliest days of Philabundance, and I learned valuable lessons. The first, my emergency food systems mentor, Pat Temple West, who headed the Philadelphia Archdiocese Nutritional Development Services, he was also one of Philabundance's first board members. And I remember him coming into my office, which was in my home at that time, and saying, you know, Pamela, this is great. You've got the logistics, you've got the marketing materials, the logo, the business model, but unless you're actually out there moving food, there is no Philabundance. So he was a very wise man. He died a couple of years ago. But his wisdom resonates, because what he knew was the power, he recognized the power of an idea, but that action is really so much more. The other story, and that sort of goes back, there's this apocryphal story that is associated with me, which is this woman in her station wagon collecting food and distributing it. Well, as a result of what Pat Temple West said to me, I thought, wait a minute, this is a transportation system, we're linking donors to recipients. I can do this in a station wagon initially. So that's how that story started, especially Mother's Day. The other story, it was a harder lesson in a way, but an important one. It's what I learned is that you must be prepared for doubt and even despair as you move ahead in certain directions and in uncharted territory in a way. I remember being sitting in a van, and it was about 6:30 in the evening. A winter evening, it was pouring rain, and I had a van full of food and was going to be looking for this shelter in North Philadelphia. And as I'm sitting there at the stoplight, I looked around at the desolation and the deprivation around me and thought, can this really make a difference? Can this possibly make a dent into the problem that I see? And of course, my family was waiting at home for dinner, so there were those pressures. When I got to my destination, a shelter for men in North Philadelphia, and the men came out to collect the food, I realized, it reinforced for me what I was doing and why. And it's really all about our interactions with individuals, with all of the individuals who cross our paths every day. And that's really what gives meaning to life. And certainly that was very early in the journey of Philabundance, but it was a lesson that that meant a lot to me. So that second question was, did you ever think it would get as big as it has? And no, I never thought that. If anyone had said to me in 1984 and 85 that Philabundance, first of all, that the problem would continue and get larger, and that the organization would grow, I would probably think, no, really, I don't think I can do this. But one step at a time is really very important. So I never anticipated that it would grow as it has, but it really, over the years, certainly friends and family, and the thousands of men, women, and children who have embraced the mission and provided food and money and volunteer support, they are the ones who make, and the employees, they are the ones who make Philabundance what it is today. The past 30 years of my life, or more than 30 years now, have really been a gift. I had the professional satisfaction of creating something from nothing, of enduring value, and realizing a vision that I had. But really more than that, it was the gift of being involved in and immersed in something that was larger than myself. And I think all of us can find that at different times. And so as I look back and talk to people about Philabundance, and it amazes me that it's more than 33 years old, it has been a gift. You've been educated here at Holy Family to be leaders in your professional and your personal lives. As you know from your studies, there is no shortage of thinking and analysis on different types of leadership. The leadership style that appeals to me, because it's very straightforward, was developed or highlighted by Bill George, a Harvard professor who was CEO of Medtronic. And he talked about the five dimensions that underpin authentic leadership. They're very simple. Understanding your purpose, following, practicing your values, leading with your heart, establishing related and important connections in your life, and making sure that you continue to practice self-discipline and self-awareness. So it's pretty simple, and I thought that I think they probably mean something to all of us, and especially all of you who've been educated and the families of the students. Understanding your values, understanding your purpose, and living it. I'm sure that there are words that and philosophies that resonate with each of you. And the one, there is a word that describes a philosophy. The word is praxis. And it was coined by a South American radical educational theorist, Paulo Freire. And what it means is reflection and action upon the world in order to transform it. And your education here at Holy Family has been preparing you to do that, to reflect upon the world around you, and to make change and to act upon it. There are a couple of strategies and truisms. I was thinking about you are sophisticated, educated individuals, so I don't know how much can be imparted to you that you don't already know and haven't already experienced, but there are a couple of strategies or truisms, I guess, that resonate for me and that are important. And one is, you don't need to be an expert to see what is possible and to achieve what's possible. I found that because when I started Philabundance, I wasn't in food service and I wasn't in social services. But by being an outsider, I was able to look at a problem in a way that the insiders couldn't. And for people who said, no, it couldn't be done, I saw that there was another way and that there was a problem to be solved. I think another Another truism or strategy is to develop the capacity to attempt to do what others will not. And, you know, this is what I'd hope for you, because that you'd become fearless and confident in your ability to step up to the plate when you see a problem, when you see something that needs changing. In your ability to do what others might not do. Someone always has to go first, so that's a good thing to remember. Another lesson that I found was to be prepared to move ahead under-resourced. And this is close to my heart because I started PhilAbundance with $1,500. Now behind that $1,500 was a lot of pro bono services and the support of people that I had met in my career who were willing to help create this. Some of the other, just very briefly, and I'm sure you find it, you need to become comfortable with uncertainty. And more than anything, to be resilient and to maintain grace under pressure. And we have so many conflicting demands, but I think it's really important that you can keep a laser focus on your mission and what it is you want to achieve in your life, personally and professionally. But the most important trait, and one that I often talk about, and that I think precedes all of the others, is empathy. You need to be able to see and feel and understand visually the world around you, and to understand what motivates people and what drives people. Empathy and listening. You will continue your education by listening to the people around you personally and professionally. And you will, with that hearing acuity and listening, you'll be able to absorb their insights and the lessons that we can learn from everyone who crosses our path. What you're doing, what you're launching today, well, really what you've been, I think, when I think about empathy, I'm thinking of different aspects of it. And what it will do, and as you know, it will inform all of your actions with everyone. It'll enable you to stay connected to the world around you, and again, as I said, listen to those around you. Your purpose, your unique impact in the world, will only come through this listening and this seeing from that very special place, that elemental space within your heart and within your soul. I thank you so much. First of all, congratulations. You have done an extraordinary, you have achieved so much. And my hat goes off to you, so congratulations. Congratulations to the families and friends who have supported the students, and I wish you the very, very best. Thank you.